Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for being here. Archbishop Kurtz will get us started in our conversation this afternoon. So, Archbishop.
Thanks, Brian. And once again, I echo thank you for being here today. Let me begin by saying that I personally and all of our archdiocese were deeply grieved at the news of an FBI investigation of Father Steve Pohl and the I want to also say that I commit once again the Archdiocese to full cooperation and to transparency in responding to this FBI investigation, as well as our efforts to offer pastoral care to all those affected, and I think especially of the families with children at St. Margaret Mary Parish and School. Last Wednesday on August 12th, when news came to me of this investigation, I immediately put Father Pohl on administrative leave. And yesterday I accepted his resignation as pastor of St. Margaret Mary Parish. We know the investigation continues. It's not completed. But nevertheless, our efforts to provide pastoral care and especially to reach out to families has already begun and will continue. I especially invite the prayers and the support of the faithful throughout the Archdiocese as this investigation goes forward. And I'd like to now ask Dr. Brian Reynolds, who has been the primary person responding to our pastoral efforts in the investigation, if he might give us an update.
Thank you, Archbishop. It might be helpful, though there was good coverage this past week of some of the early events. Let's walk through what occurred over the last 8 days and leading up to some important information that happened yesterday. As Archbishop said, this information came to us beginning last Wednesday, August 12th. And when we had heard about the investigation, we confirmed the information directly with the cyber crimes unit of the FBI. And as Archbishop said, Father Pohl was put on administrative leave. The following day, on Thursday, Archbishop appointed Father Mark Spaulding, who's the Vicar General of the Archdiocese and pastor of Holy Trinity Parish, as temporary administrator of St. Margaret Mary. On Friday, we met with the staff of the church and filled them in on the information and prepared Father Mark and Father Jeff Schooner, our vicar for priests, to be present at each of the weekend masses last weekend to speak with the congregation that gathered. On Monday, we met with all the faculty of the school and were present with staff from our counseling office and others as parents and students arrived for open house that they had on Monday. Just yesterday, we received an interim report from Detective Dan Jackman with the Cyber Crimes Unit. He provided us with two pieces of important information. First, while the investigation will continue for quite some time, they were aware of two facts. One is that Father Pohl had numerous, up to 200, they reported, photos of St. Margaret Mary school children on his computer or cell phone or other places. These pictures were apparently taken on parish grounds. We were informed that the children were fully clothed in the pictures, but the authorities described some of the pictures as inappropriate. The second discovery that was reported to us that in their initial investigation, they did learn that Father Pohl had downloaded child pornography on some of his personal computer equipment and other technology. Again, Detective Jackman said these are preliminary things, that in fact this may take a number of months before a full review of all the different things is complete. Archbishop accepted yesterday, then with that information, accepted the resignation of the parish, from the parish, from Father Pohl. And the process then begins to appoint a new pastor, a permanent pastor, and that usually takes a number of weeks before that occurs. As you might expect, then, last night we met with parents, particularly from the school. Several hundred gathered with Father Mark Spaulding and myself and parish and school staff. They expressed anger, pain, and fear would be the three primary emotions they shared. While we had counselors and there to help talk one-on-one with those who wanted to talk, and we gave information that I've just shared with you, there was a general concern of what will we know and when will we know it. But as we expressed, most of the information from an investigation like this won't be coming from the Archdiocese, but from the civil authorities as they complete their investigation. We have been hearing, as you have, from numerous family members and parents and others with a whole cadre of questions. And regrettably, oftentimes we've had to redirect them to the investigative officers because we don't have information. We've seen none of the photographs. We've seen none of the information. We just know the reports they've given to us that I've already outlined. So we know you've heard, and therefore we wanted to continue our process of being as public and transparent as we can with this. As Archbishop said, we have provided counselors to assist the already able counselors they have at the school in talking with family members or children if they wish to talk. We've had meetings, and there'll be more, with parents and groups who may want to discuss it at the parish. And we provided written materials, mostly to assist parents in talking to their own children about these matters. We have a victim assistance coordinator in the Archdiocese, Martine Siegel, who's particularly made herself available in these conversations. I share, on a personal note, as Archbishop did, my own personal regret that such a dynamic is occurring. It's painful for everybody involved, and certainly we understand people's emotions in this stressful time. We're able to answer a few questions for you, but we really don't have a lot more information to share than what we've offered there for you. But Archbishop or I will be glad to answer. Steve? I really don't. They didn't describe those for me. I specifically asked whether this involved photographs of nudity, and they said no. But it wasn't a place for us to start examining pictures. They did report that usually in a circumstance like this, after they have a collection of pictures, they bring them to the authorities of a school and they ask, confirm, are they the students, and then they would share them with their parents.
Any indications to whether these pictures were taken with or without these children's knowledge?
I really don't know. From what I understand, because many of the parents talked about their children having been in photographs, that many of them were taken with notification, but I can't say they all were.
How long had he been taking these pictures?
Don't have a time. He's been pastor since 2008 at the parish. I don't have a timeline for the pictures they've discovered.
Had he shared them at all?
As far as we know, these were simply what they found on his equipment, but we don't have evidence. We don't have evidence that he shared them. Usually when it comes to matters like this, there's three questions that get asked around the collection of, or the transmission of, or the creation of pornography. And what they reported to us is two things: that there was a collection of pictures that were clothed pictures but inappropriate, and that there was a collection of pornography on the equipment. That's all they had reported to us.
Any, for the photos, is there gender, a certain gender in the photos, certain ages?
For what they've said to me, that's both boys and girls. I don't have an age for you, other than they do refer to them as being school children. I don't know. You'd have to direct that to the investigators. I haven't seen the photos.
Dr. Reynolds, do you all continue your internal investigation?
We don't. We do to the degree that we stay present to what way can be helpful to families who have something to share. But if they have a concern, want to report what they may think was inappropriate, from a fear to a crime, we encourage them to directly contact the authorities. We step back from an internal investigation so as not interfere with theirs. When they briefed us, as they did yesterday, Archbishop Kurtz took the action that resulted in the resignation of Father Pohl. But we don't interview people. We leave that to the experts.
Any indication that any of these pictures were posed?
I really can't comment. I don't know. I understand one family member, one family a while back learned from their child that a picture had been taken that bothered the child, so they got a copy of the picture and they gave it to the authorities, who began their investigation.
What's the process? He has resigned, but does that mean he still can be a priest?
Yeah, there's Archbishop, I don't want to comment on that process.
Maybe make a little comment on that. There's first of all, we want to be true to the civil law as well as canon law, or the church law. Civil law, as Dr. Reynolds mentioned, we want to cooperate and not interfere. That's our main focus right now. With canon law, there are processes, naturally, that we go through. The first step that I take as the bishop is to remove the priest from administrative activity. That means he cannot provide any pastoral care nor present himself as a priest. Now, that can be for a period of time, but not an unlimited period of time. And so our intention would be that the primary issue here is cooperation with the investigation. So we do not want to interfere with the investigation, but the steps that have been taken now is he's no longer the pastor, and he is not able to present himself as a priest in pastoral care or simply in public in that way. Yeah, you're naturally, I don't blame you. You're getting a little ahead of the process. So there are canon law would give a number of procedures and paths that can be taken. The primary issue here is cooperation and safety of the faithful. They're the two major areas, and that's what our concentration is on now.
So right now you're not planning to pursue that.
We're concentrating on those two areas, the important areas, and in fact they're taking all of our energy, to be very honest with you.
Is he still staying on parish grounds, or where is he?
He's not on parish grounds. Yeah.
Was he living on parish grounds before?
He was living in a rectory that was not in the school, but on the same grounds as the campus. Well, there is a process canonically that we would follow, but he himself offered his resignation, and I accepted it.
What can you say to ease parents' concerns? They don't know exactly what these pictures.
Well, I mean, to be very honest with you, pastorally, I'm feeling the grief that I can only imagine parents are feeling. I think Dr. Reynolds said very clearly, there's anger, there's confusion, and there's hurt and fear. And so right now our job, I believe, is to walk with people, because not every parent will have the same response or reaction, but in all cases we need to accompany people to assure them of our resolve to reach out to people and help them, especially our children. The church, of course, has been so well known and will continue to be in providing pastoral care, our Catholic schools. So we continue to do that, and we do it with great earnest. We also are very firm in responding to any violations of what we call our charter or our ethics, and we are pursuing that.
Had he not resigned, would you have taken steps within the governance of the church to
What we would do, I'd have to go back first. It's a great question. I would have to make sure that the timing with regard to is cooperating with the investigation. The first step is cooperate with the investigation and remove the priest from any pastoral care. And that would be the first two steps that would be taken.
Yeah. Has this investigation caused the FBI to expand it to any other priests within this?
I'm not aware of. Not that I'm aware of. Yeah.
So when they talk about personal computers, were these computers that he had that were either in the rectory or in the parish or the school?
You might answer that. Right.
The equipment that they took from Father Pohl was his personal equipment, his personal computer, and I believe either a laptop or an iPad, his cell phone. Those are his personal property. They were So the focus was his personal property, not the equipment in his office over in the parish center. I know they checked that, but they didn't take that equipment with them. What they were looking for was his personal equipment.
Has the FBI or have you all been able to identify all of the children in those pictures, or have you been?
We haven't seen any. We haven't been seeing any of the pictures. That the information that we shared was as new as yesterday afternoon. That they told us their preliminary investigation was the two things I said: several hundred pictures and some downloading on his own personal equipment, and that led to the actions that took place yesterday, and the information we shared with parents last night. There will be further information. One of the things that Detective Jackman was really clear about, there's two documents that get created in an investigation. One is a warrant that is to search property, and that occurred last Wednesday. The second is an affidavit, which provides the reason for why they got a warrant. The affidavit, he said to me, has only been seen by three people: him, the judge, and the prosecutor. So we haven't seen the affidavit, no one else has seen the affidavit. It's sealed, it's a legal seal by the judge, and so we don't know what is behind it more than we've shared now. We have some of the same questions that everybody has. No, that is one of the questions. Sure, it's one of the questions parents have, and I believe what will, from what he has shared with us, there will come a time that he brings the whatever they have collected to the public, and the affidavit will become public, and then more information will be forthcoming. This information's just been a week old now. We've tried the first day to immediately act. We did releases to parents and parishioners and even the media in the first couple of days, and we're back today because there's new information, and we'll continue that pattern. When we have information to share, we promise the parents and the schools and the church parishioners to be transparent and public with what we discover.
If parents talk to their children and find out that indeed their children were the subjects of some of these pictures, based on your meetings last night, did you advise them to come to the church first, or to contact the FBI first, or to do that simultaneously?
We told them specifically to contact Detective Jackman. He gave his direct email and cell phone numbers to try and have contact him directly, not us. Now, certainly any information that's given to us, we would forward to them. We're not conducting an investigation. If a parent were to say to a staff member of the school that they're concerned, they would be instructed and given a document. We actually emailed to each of the families the copy of those phone numbers and the email addresses.
Would any action that you take under canon law essentially be waiting for whatever works its way through the process in the criminal courts?
Exactly right. The church law yields to the civil process first, so that information by the experts can be gathered, so the Archbishop is provided information from that investigation as part of his process. Yes.
I might simply add, because I think it's a great focus, our primary concentration right now is safety of everyone and pastoral care. And so anything related to safety and pastoral care, we are taking responsibility to do our best to respond. And I do need to say that both Dr. Reynolds, Father Mark Spaulding, the principal and staff at St. Margaret Mary have been exemplary in their efforts to reach out. But it's all very, very new to us, and part of transparency is being able to share it as soon as we can. We will, however, continue to cooperate with the civil authorities who are taking the lead in terms of many of the questions that you're asking.
How was it that the parent came upon the picture of the child that you referenced that was disturbed by the contents of the picture?
I'm not sure. I know that. Do you know?
No, I don't have enough detail about that. I believe the child told his parents about the picture taking, and then I don't know after that what occurred.
Picture taking, so there was more than one?
I don't know. There was a picture taken. I believe a child reported that to his parents. His parents then got a copy of the picture and reported that to the authorities. I don't know all the steps in there.
Really a question for
the authorities.
They
conducted all that. I don't have a timeline that they followed in there. The other thing to say is that this response is also connected to our general safety program. I just want to briefly speak to that. We have each of our staff members and volunteers in our schools and churches are required to go through background checks and training around these kinds of matters, that talk about things about collection of pornography, talks about things like inappropriate touching, talks about things like spending time alone. All those are written policies, and everybody has a copy of them. All of our school children and our parish children are participate in safe environment classes, where they're given information in a program called Speak Up, Be Safe, that teaches them, if you have a concern, raise it. Now, I don't know who the family originally reported this is, but I'm hopeful that the work we're doing every day in our schools, equipping people, is when you're feeling uncomfortable, report it to a responsible authority, particularly your parents. So if you have a concern, go there, and I'm hopeful that's what would have happened in this kind of situation. We do know that that's what our emphasis is.
Other than to confirm or to make you aware that the FBI was investigating it, has Father Pohl talked about the specifics of these allegations with anybody connected to the church, either at the parish level or at the archdiocese?
No, he has not. He reported that he had been received the warrant for his personal property, and which we then contacted the authorities to confirm that had occurred, and that led to him being placed on administrative leave.
What is his side of the story?
His side of the story.
What
he hasn't discussed the allegations with, other than to say these are the facts that he was received a warrant. One of the things that we know very carefully to do, we've learned these lessons ourselves, is not to investigate these things, but turn it right to the authorities. So within an hour of hearing about the warrant, I had a conversation with the authorities myself, with Detective Jackman, and he confirmed, yes, these are the things that they're doing, and that information was given to the Archbishop, who took his action.
And I could, if I could just add one thing, it's a legitimate question. When I removed Father Pohl from administrative activities, I urged him to cooperate with the investigation, so that we were not, he knew that we would not be conducting a parallel investigation right now, but we would be cooperating with the FBI. So many of the questions you're going to ask are, of course, legitimate questions, but they're questions that will have to either be given to those investigating from the FBI or wait until we have that results and can ourselves then take the steps that we need to take.
Is the Archdiocese still housing Father Pohl, and has he retained counsel as far as you know?
We're not housing Father Pohl. He's made personal arrangements himself. Important, while he has some church restriction placed upon him, he has no civil restriction placed upon him at this particular moment. So there's been no action taken in the civil arena. So he's providing for himself in terms of a place to live. I forgot your second part.
Has he retained counsel, or have you been?
I believe he has, but I don't know a name. Okay, thank you very much for your time and for your coverage, and we'll be available as time goes by with more information. Thank you, Archbishop. And thanks again for coming.